Tuesday, September 5th, 2017, at 7 p.m. Mr. Lowry, when you're ready.
Mayor Lowry.
Here.
Mr. Lindsey.
Here.
Mr. Heine.
Here.
Mr. Rick Lowry.
Here.
Mr. Lethley.
Present.
Mr. Craybrock.
Here.
Six members present.
Thank you, sir. All right, tonight we'll have the invocation by Councilman Aaron White.
We bow our heads. Dearly Father, we gather here tonight, ever mindful of your graces to us. Lord, we know that you're the giver of all things good, and we're thankful. Lord, we're thankful that you oversee everything in the city, every citizen, every worker, every officer, every first responder, and every council member, and even every accident, Lord. We especially give thanks when you place your protective hand over our most beloved citizen, Lord. We ask that you bless everyone here tonight. Guide our hearts to better serve New Carolina. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Actions on the, we need to do these separately, Jean, if we're doing together.
What's your pleasure?
Well,
Mr. Mayor.
Keep them together.
Mr. Lethley.
He's perfect.
Okay, Mr.
Move to accept our meeting minutes of 8/21/17, a special meeting of 8/22/17.
Second.
Motion by Mr. Lindsey, second for Mr. Light.
Council, any questions, comments, discussion before we move forward? You ready?
Before we vote on that, I just want to make a comment. I know at the last meeting when I was absent, Mr. Grimm had asked that the new son be removed from his public comments.
The New Carolina News.
Yeah, the New Carolina News. And
that's the other
son. Yeah, the New Carolina News.
I got some news.
Anyway. I originally received an email that I don't know if it came direct from me, but I think it was copied from you to me, that I did change that. It has been changed in these original minutes. It just wasn't changed in the old minutes.
Okay.
That was correct.
Thank you, sir. And no questions from council? Mr. Pauley, you're ready?
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lethley?
Yes.
Mr. Craybrocker?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsey?
Yes.
Mr. Light?
Yes.
The minutes passed 6-0.
Thank you, sir. Just real quick before we move on, I just want to let everyone know that I'm sure after an unfortunate incident last night on Main Street, that, to let everyone know that New Carolina News family, the Reardon family, Deputy Shaw, everyone on our thoughts and prayers are going out to them. Everything works out. That being said, we'll move on to communications. None tonight. City Manager's report is attached. Mr. Bridge.
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, members of the council, members of the public. Get this page real quick. Under informational items, there's an equipment shared agreement that I will be signing. Village of Ian will be doing a hydrant repair on their fire hydrants. They need to borrow our backhoe because it has hydraulic ability on it. I think they're going to have about 30 days. I did want council to see that agreement. You guys will not be voting on that agreement. I did have one that took over this equipment sharing agreement. Everything is good to go. So any questions on that? We're happy to attempt to answer them. Yes, sir.
Mr. Lindsey.
Is this a one-time agreement or is this a ongoing yearly or continuous?
I think that this is, don't quote me on it, maybe at one time. Anytime that we'll do a different piece of equipment or a different scenario, it will be another agreement.
Okay, thank you, sir.
Yes.
No.
All right. An income tax petition, the Board of Elections denied our protest at the hearing that we had. That tax credit will appear on this November's ballot. We will have to set a few work sessions to come together as a team to get the word out to the citizens. Also, with that being said, we'll probably have to have, my recommendation is a work session every week that we do not have a council meeting. I think we need to hit this hard, we need to hit it thoroughly, and we need to come together as a council administration and get our best foot forward to our citizens about the, what was going to happen in the past. We will have to do two budgets, two capital improvement plans, the scenario A and the scenario B. I guess, citizens, just keep tuned to the council meetings, and once we set these dates, I think everyone should come, but they will be definitely open to the public. This is not the news that we wanted to hear from the Board of Elections, but they have said their piece, and this is where we are with the tax credit position as current. Alternative formula of the local government fund was approved by Clark County on 8/25/17. They are looking into the statutory formula to determine if there's any differences in allocations. Right now, we don't have any indication that whatever the formula they're going to use would be more or less money to the city. So I think the city of Springfield has a statutory formula. Lindsay was present with me and Vice Mayor Craybacher at the meeting when they approved this formula. They may have additional information to share. If not, then we'll just have to wait to see what that statutory formula would be. With that being said, also, they would have to have, correct me if I'm wrong, majority of the voters to change it, or City of Springfield has to agree to change it as well.
Basically, all they have done is Springfield. Mm-hmm. Also, they said either if Springfield or Clark County commissioners voted no, it would be done, it would be over. That both of them has to agree to amend this agreement.
But then they said too, sometimes if you had a majority of the people in there.
We've got the what they said was if everybody else in that pie came together and said, we want this to change, it still goes back to Springfield and Clark County commissioners, and if either one of them voted no, it would not happen. If those two agreed to it, it doesn't matter what the rest of us wants, is basically what they said. So basically, they're telling us and the rest of the city, the villages and townships in Clark County, the Clark County commissioners and Springfield City Commission is dictating what everybody else is getting. The three of us voiced our concerns with that, our protest over that. I was probably a little more verbal than the rest of them on disagreeing with them. And basically there's nothing we can do unless Springfield and Clark County agrees to give up more of the pie. And Springfield getting the 48 point something, I forget the exact number, as 48% of the pie. We get 0.7. I think the park rangers, park district gets 1.25, I believe, is the percentage that they get. And those are the only three I remember. So.
The park district gets a little bit more.
Yeah, they get 1.25%. We get less than 1%. And I think as a city, and we are the second city in this county, we should get a little bit more of the pie, because Springfield has all the industrial stuff that they can recoup any loss that they would have, but I don't believe that will happen anytime soon. So, did I cover that pretty well? What was that?
My stance is there is like, we don't know what the number is going to be. So yeah. Until you show me a number, they could change the formula, we could be out without additional dollars. We just don't know what those numbers are. So until we know what those numbers are, there's no really sense of debating the issue.
Well, I think it's sad, personally, because it just shows that Springfield gets a lot more than what we do. What is the basis of the formula? And they said, the basis of the formula is the need. I go, how do you know that? And nobody can answer that. The accountant can answer that, Federer can answer that.
I just don't, nobody's seen the statutory form, or they couldn't even tell you what variables went into calculate that form.
Exactly.
But at the end of the day, there's zero reason to get upset or kind of have a heated argument when we don't know what the numbers are going to be in the first place. My opinion on it is I think since the county does administer these funds, they should know that in the back of their hand. The only thing I took away from that is why does City Springfield have this formula and not you guys? So that was really the only fault that I could fault for. So yeah, this is where we're at with it.
Mr. Lowry?
We have our operating center here.
Yes.
Is it possible to research this in other states, other counties? Research the formula, and if we feel it is wrong or unjust?
Well,
we have a court system in this country.
I would say let them do the legwork first. We're supposed to be looking into that before we spend our own funds.
Okay.
Give them some time. If they don't produce what we need to produce, and then we've got having our attorney look at some things.
Thank you.
Sure.
All right, thank you.
No problem. And moving on, street lighting assessments. The last day to pay your city building, your street lighting assessments at the city building is tomorrow. So if you don't want that 4% fee added on to that, stop by the city building tomorrow, ask what your charge is. You can call beforehand. We have a massive Excel sheet that says what you owe. Calls beforehand, we can let you know what it is. Come to the city building and you'll avoid that 4% fee by the auditors placing it onto your property tax. Again, tomorrow is the last day, but in the business day to get that done. Then we do have to send everything off to the auditor's office.
That's 4% of what you actually owe.
4% on top of what you're owed. Okay. And then we have a citizen shout out. Mr. Dewey Brosey, our fantastic front row guy here, has been awarded the Max Grave Award. There is an information attached to this council packet, and it's in simple as an email form. I want to say that presentation is September 18th at 5:45, which is the day of our council meeting. So I would say go get your award, then come to our council meeting.
That's about 5:45.
I'm going to
be late.
Well, you'll be late. But I think you might want to go get the award before you come to the council meeting.
No,
you
know? You should still have time.
You'll have time. Yeah. I would love to go and show my support for you. I can't risk going that far and have to be back by 7 o'clock. But Dewey, you are a fantastic person. And, you know, hats off to you for getting this award, sir.
I'm just too old to be floating around that ball.
Well, regardless of or not, you are a good spirit. You're a good person. And you know what? Citizens should be very thankful we have a guy in your stature that's with us today. So hats off to you, sir.
Can I tell you a quick story about Dewey? I think it's kind of interesting.
Sure.
Maybe you guys want to tell you about it. A couple weeks ago, the Northampton Street Fair had a veterans ceremony, and we had talked about recognizing the oldest veteran that was going to be there. So I invited Dewey, made sure Dewey came. So Dewey shows up, and I'm thinking, Dewey's got this. Dewey's 96 years old. He's done it. Sure enough, sitting in the front row was a guy who was 97.
No! You got beat out by a year.
Unbelievable.
What? You got beat out by a year, huh? He was 97, you were 96?
Yeah.
So, well.
Maybe next year.
Second.
Maybe next year.
That's a rough one.
Wasn't expecting that.
Just keep moving, that's all.
That's all you can do, that's right.
You got to answer
that. But yeah, I enjoy our conversations. You are just fantastic. You got some of the best stories. So thank you for being an awesome member of this community. And I think a lot of people share the same viewpoint as I do.
Yes.
I do believe that's all I have for the city manager's report. I'd be happy to entertain any questions or comments.
Councilman, what's your comments for city manager? Thank you, Mr. Bridge. Moving on, let's see more comments from members of the public. If anybody have any questions or comments, please go to the podium with your name and address, please.
Ronald Goff, 202 Bill Drive. I know you don't have a contingency plan in effect yet for what's coming here in 2 months. I don't know any answer. I'm scared of what's going to happen. I mean, I've got too much invested in this city. I've got property here that I can't afford to lose. And going door to door right now, people are highly, especially the young people, that they're the ones that are in favor of the voting, in favor of taking that 1.5 away. Something that I thought of, maybe I don't know how you feel about it, is before the election, if we got out and maybe, half percent of the incentive given back to the taxpayers to live on 1%, I'm up there to lose a half and a whole 1.5%. So that's just one idea. Yes, we're definitely going to have to now talk to people. When I go door to door, I'm telling people, don't vote for this to do away with this. We can't afford it. And I've had people tell me I'm stupid. I'm sorry, if you feel that way, go ahead, I don't care. But I take trust and pride in my city I live in. I don't have the answer, I know what's at stake to lose. And I don't want to see that. You know, we're going to lose the deputies. I do have one question, though, and I don't know who to address this to. If we're contracting with the Elizabeth Township, and this would take effect, we would, I don't want to say, go down the drain. What's the repercussion out of that by not fulfilling that contract?
I don't know.
Well, since the fire is not paid out of the general fund, the fire is supported by its own levies. So the fire is not affected by the potential cuts out of the general fund. The contract with Elizabeth Township goes until the end of 2018. Then it's over. We'll discuss a new one, but again, the fire is not involved in the general fund.
Okay, how soon would this take effect if this did pass on the ballot? Can I ask that?
Absolutely. It's 15 days after the election. And it's no different than our ordinances when they're effective 15 days after council passes them. It's the same scenario. So we're looking at losing tax money not only in 18, but about a month and a half of 17.
I'm not, you know, like I say, we've got people here that's got several properties in the city. They're going to lose on it. My wife pays here, plus she works in Humor. When I worked, I paid Dayton here and where else I worked at. And, you know, I was paying up almost 7%. I don't have the answer, but I don't know. I mean, I'll be more happy to sit down with them any way I can. I don't want to see this gone. But I don't know how the 0.5% you would feel about giving the incentive of a 0.5% trying to keep the 1%.
Can I comment on that?
Yes, sir.
The last time that the city operated on 1% income tax, we were about negative. How much money did we have when we took over? The thing of it is, Mr. Cobb, is, and I don't say this to be disrespectful to anyone, the city of New Carlisle has a very low income tax rate. To go down any further, you're not going to make any progress, to be honest with you. We need to look at, you know, if this goes on the ballot and passes, we need to look at how do we want to move forward. We're not allowing any growth, even at 1.5%, even though we stock a little bit away every year, it's still not a lot of money for a municipal government of 6,000 people to really operate on, you know. To say to go down again to 0.5, you're just putting us right back in a position where they have to go up to the 1.5. You know, it's not cheaper than it was a couple years ago. Things have gotten more expensive.
But if you lose that whole 1.5%, that's a more devastating, correct?
Well, it is, but you know, I mean, here's the thing, this council can't decide on the 0.5%. That has to be put up to voters. So it's not like they can say, we're just going to let you guys go on 0.5% anyway. You know, so. You know, it's definitely a ballot initiative type scenario.
Ron?
I know, I applaud the outside box thinking. It truly does make sense, but you're just, I mean, if you give it, again, 0.5%, you can take us right back to the 1% we're having on before. You know, I think people in New Carlisle, they need to realize, they need to look at the average income of a family in here, which is just under $40,000, maybe it'd be 36 or 37. Out of the aging population that we have, that are retired. If you look at those numbers, it's going to tell you need to move forward. You need to look at ways to increase your revenue. not taken away. Is this going to put us right back in the same position we were in?
I understand that. I mean, I'm just trying to figure out a way to keep the city here. I don't want the state in here because the state can come in and mandate any worse than 2 to 6% income tax, no questions asked.
Right. Well, what we have here is the Board of Elections felt as though that the democratic process needed to take place. So they've approved it to go on the ballot, and that's where we're standing now. It's going to go on the ballot. The citizens will vote on it. If the citizens vote in that way, we can educate them to their blue in the face. If that's how this city votes to give that tax credit, that's what they have spoken to do. That is the democratic process that we've all been under since the inception of our country. Doesn't mean that we're not going to combat it. Doesn't mean that we're not going to maybe look at ways to maybe put an income tax increase on the ballot to combat that. But at this point in time, I mean, it's just going on about, we'll educate people as we feel that we need to educate them. But there's nothing we can do to stop them. People are going to vote how they see fit. And I understand you're thinking outside the box tax credit or 0.5% reduction, but this has to happen first, and then the other stuff has to follow after. So you can't even tie some saying, if you vote no for this, we'll give you 0.5%, correct? We'll reduce your income tax by 0.5%. You can't even say that. So my advice to everyone in council is, honestly, let it ride. I mean, it's going to go on the ballot. We can do our best to educate, saying this is what's going to happen. If people choose to believe us, great. If they don't and it fails, these cuts will happen on November 8th. And that's now your reality that you live in. And once those cuts take place, it'll be up to the citizens and this council to raise the income tax rate, to put that on the ballot. If that doesn't fail, I mean, if that doesn't go through, we'll have to operate until we're out of money. And once that happens, the state will come in. You're absolutely correct about that. But there's not a single thing that I can do or these guys can do other than educating and praying for the best.
I mean, I understand that there's 20% that's going to eat the burden of this in this community.
The what? I'm sorry.
20% of the people that live and work in the city are going to eat the burden of it if this passes on November
2nd. I didn't hear you.
Eat the burden.
Eat the burden.
The burden cheaper.
Sure.
And the other 60%, I'm going to say, are going to rejoice on it, I should say. Mm-hmm. And I'm just trying to figure out some kind of solution. I mean, I don't know at all. I mean,
it's a tough scenario, and you are right. I think there's a lot of people scared. I'm scared. I'm going to have to tell people they're not, you know, they're potentially not going to have it. You know, you guys are homeowners, have to face the ripple effect of that. But we have done everything we legally could possibly do to stop this. I mean, so I don't want people to think that we didn't do anything, but we did. We filed a petition for our attorney was involved. We did everything we legally could to stop this from the Board of Elections from allowing that protest, or from disapproving that protest. You know, we might have some other options that our attorney will go into executive session right to update the council on. But it's no one's fault. It's Ms. Bartlett's right as a citizen to do what she did. It is the citizen's right to sign that petition. And it's our right to say we don't want this to go down. But there's not going to be an easy solution. There's just truly not.
Well, let me ask another quick question. If this would pass, which would wipe out the 1.5% for the people who work elsewhere and live here, does that still let the city come back and impose 0.5% in there without the voter drink or without the...
We're not getting rid of our income tax. If you live and work in the city, you're still going to pay the 1.5% income tax. We're not getting rid of the income tax.
If the people that work elsewhere would not pay that 1.5%,
then they get the...
If it passes.
Well, if it passes and they get a credit of 1.5% of our income tax they pay to another city.
But still, though, they're not going to be passing, not paying that 1.5%. It won't be on the
board. They're going to have a credit. This is for people, if you live and work in the city, you will still pay income tax. If you live in the city and work outside of the city where they have like a 1% income tax, then you'll pay your 0.5% to the city you brought on.
But if you work in a city that has above 1.5%,
which is all of
them, we have one of the lowest income tax rates there is, you will end up paying where you work and not where you live. The 1.5 income tax rate is almost unheard of nowadays. New Carlisle has been like that forever. And again, you see the results of that. You know, we don't have an unsustainable fund, we don't have top of line equipment, you know. That's just the thing, that's just how it works. I mean, that's just the, that is the honest opinion of how it works. We have it, okay, so like we had a 3% income tax. And if you worked in Dayton, Manatee, and you would end up paying 1% back in the city. But since most people are higher than 1.5, we're not getting that.
I'm with you. I'm saying yeah. Try to fight.
No, I'm not saying go.
Well, I want them on your side. Also, just to let you know, I mean, this is just, it's just a plot for early stages, I guess, if you will. If this fails in November, and I called Randy a few weeks ago. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. A few weeks ago, I called Randy, and I said, look, if this fails, and for whatever reason, I have a gut feeling it will. That's just me. I asked Randy if we could go ahead, whether we think it'll be, you know, whether it'll work or not. I asked Randy, so let's set up a meeting with, let's just start with Bay, the biggest city around. Whether it's him, the attorney, and the finance director, and a few council members, or all of us, whatever it may be, and see if we're willing, like I said, if this fails, and we can go ahead and show the effort that we're going to try and work with these other cities. I have a hard time believing that Dayton would ever say, okay, we'll give your citizens a tax break of, you know, whatever, 0.25% or 50%.
It's not, but
I think we need to go ahead and do it and try. I mean, if you think about how many citizens are in Carlisle, let's say it's around 5,800. How many people in New Carlisle are actually working? It's probably around, I don't know, 3,000 maybe.
Yeah. That's, the state of Ohio is not participating in tax processing. And that's exactly what that would be. And then we talked about it. It's not a legal practice in Ohio, or is it not?
I need to look at that before we talk about.
Yeah, but you're right, because there's no way Dayton or any other city is going to say, yeah, we'll go.
Right, because they would start to change that.
And that's the thing about it, is people are getting this credit confused with a reciprocal agreement.
Right.
State of Ohio does not participate in reciprocal agreements. That practice ended in the 1970s. There is no revenue share. New Carlisle receives no money if you work outside of the city, and the income tax rate is higher than 1.5%. There is no revenue sharing. There is no exchange of monies whatsoever. It is, you don't pay New Carlisle. You pay where you work. That's the truth.
No, he's not finished coming. Oh, just put everybody else.
You good, Ron?
No, all I'm saying, I'm trying to work with it, and I don't have all the answers. And I mean, when I worked in Dayton, I questioned the 2.5% plus what I paid 1.5 here. Dayton said, you're paying us 2.5 to drive on our streets. Yeah. Springfield tells you the same thing. Springfield, matter of fact, it's increased 0.5% to pay for the drugs. I don't agree with that. You know, why should I have to pay for somebody's own drugs? We don't have that problem here yet. I don't know what the answer is. I want to work with you to try to save this.
And I think that we're all on the same page. It's no one's fault up there. It is on the ballot. It's no one's fault on this side. This is on the ballot. And I spoke to the council members. Listen, there is no room for division right now. You know, if somebody doesn't like something a council member did, let it go. If you don't like some of the things that I've done or I've said, let it go. This is our one time to come together. We may have disagreeing opinions. I know you and I do.
Oh, yeah.
This is the one thing that we agree on. I think this is the one thing that most people in this audience right now can't agree on. We do not want this to pass. So let's come together. The more heads, the merrier. You know, so I'm going to have these work sessions in this council. It's going to be in a public setting. Citizens need to come. And I spoke with Mr. Lighty today on November 6th. I am going to suggest that we have a town hall meeting, wherever that may be, the day before the election, to hit it home one more time. I don't want it to pass. You don't want it to pass. You don't want it to pass. And if you are up there and you want it to pass, sorry guys, you might want to resign. But, you know, I mean, here's an opportunity to see positive out of the darkness. Let's come together, show this town that we can work together, and get it done. And I'm with Mr. Mayor. It still has to go to the ballot. You know, there are people out there that truly just don't get it, that I talk to on the phone. And once they hear it, they're like, oh, that makes no sense. You know, I hope to think there's a lot more common sense in this town than not. And I think once everybody comes together and we, this council pushes with their public of what's going to happen to their city, hopefully people get it. But at the end of the day, it's a democratic process. We can do whatever we can to combat it. It's still going to go to the ballot, and we need to be prepared. If it does fail, we move on to normal. If it passes, November 8th, this is what the citizens get. And so that income tax is raised again.
All right. Thank you, Mr. Cobb. Anyone else in the audience have any questions or comments tonight? All right. Thank you. Mr. Water.
Thank you. Frank, you spoke a little bit about thunder.
I'm sorry.
No, that's fine. And I wanted to bring up, maybe not calling a town hall meeting, but a meeting before this happened. And I don't like to use, I wouldn't like to use the word educate. And for people, the thing that fascinates me is so many people think that if this passes, and I'll use my wife for example, she works in Mandate, believe it or not, she works at a Dayton address but pays 2% taxes to Mandate, plus here. They think that she's not going to be able to pay Mandate tax. It's all going to come back to me. And I don't know how many people I talk to that are saying that. Well, if this passes, just they don't have to pay in that city. That money will come back, and we really need to get that in black and white and hold informational meetings. And I think, for lack of a better term, town hall meeting is the thing to do. I think we need to start advertising today and get it out there and get as many people to find the biggest venue we can find to hold it and get this information out, because there's a ton of wrong information out there.
November 6th, I'll reach out to New Carlisle Elementary.
Yes, sir. I think that's way too late.
Yeah.
Every time I say that, so many people vote absentee ballot.
Yes.
I vote absentee ballot. Well,
I think we need to have it too, because also what I've learned is that people will go if they wait 10 weeks.
Yes.
The pass is gone, and they may not, be so hard hit. The reason I had suggested November 6th is because it goes into a Friday, Saturday, Sunday, weekend. So I think we should have one maybe end of October and another one in November 6th.
How about two?
When, that's what I said. When is early voting?
One afternoon, one morning.
I don't know.
Well, we'll target it a couple days before early voting, and then the other second town hall meeting will be the day before the actual election.
Third day, right.
Mr. Bridge,
it's not
we? Oh, okay. The council, I know no one's going right there, so about a weekend. I have no problem with the weekend, but the citizens may have a problem with the weekend.
No, I mean, as one option, because there's probably people that work, say,
exactly. It could be helpful to have a weekend and week.
Right. Well, it's also, I'm not trying to be funny when I say this. Everyone, I'm not trying to be funny, but we are in the state of Ohio. College football Saturdays are back, and that takes a lot of people. I mean, I'm not trying to be funny, but he's happy for me. That,
well,
well, if we bring wings, I think it'll be okay.
Guys, I'm not trying to be funny, but I do know a lot of
people. Absolutely.
If I say, Ohio State plays at noon or 3 o'clock, depending on who they play, I'm just saying.
The good thing is most Ohio State games are in the later afternoon, seriously.
I don't know why you want to
get into so many
tonight. One last question. Would it be possible, this may be way out of line, but I'm going to ask. Would it be possible at this meeting that you have representation from Aiden or Kevin?
I can't do that. I can't
you can answer that.
Why would we have one out there to talk about the recycling?
Just so they can get the report that what you're thinking can't happen. Because, like I said, that's what people think.
Well, they can
be taxed in another city and the city's going to send it back to them.
I'm not trying to be disrespectful to you, but
that's
I don't think that would work.
Okay.
They're not going to take their own time, especially on a Saturday or if it's evening. They're not going to come up here. And the reason I say that is because we're going to look into it, and don't quote me on this, I think reciprocal agreements in the state of Ohio are illegal. Back in the 70s, they stopped the process. But no one from Dayton or Ryan Wise would be like, yes, we'll give up some of our income tax to...
No, to let people know that it can't happen. That's what I'm saying.
They have nothing.
Exactly. That's what I want them to hear from them.
But no, Dayton has nothing to gain.
You're right.
I see what you're saying. But we'll get the word out.
Okay, hold on, just a second. Services, Mr. Lightning.
Well, I was going to say, just real quick, so we'll have the town hall meetings, the work session meetings, I think is really what's going to be informative for people.
Yeah.
Is there any way we can, as soon as we get the date set, you said you want to have it every week, that there is a council meeting, it's probably a good idea. That way, at least if you're on the fence, you can find one to go to. We put that like all over Facebook, maybe like in the paper, we're going to meet on these days. And that way, I mean, you can at least make it to one if you have any questions. And you can actually see what it's going to do to the budget on both sides.
Oh, yeah, never in the public.
Okay, well, yeah. I mean, but think of part of me.
Absolutely, I agree with you. 100%. So, do we want to do one on the weekend?
I think so.
As long as it's early. Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah.
Mr. Brink, would you be so kind as to publish your business if you call out? It's going to depend on this to
publish what?
Publish what?
A schedule. If we get a schedule of all the meetings we're going to have, could you get that in paper, please? Appreciate it.
It'll be published in realized.
Yeah.
Right, but I mean,
I'm going to insert, sorry to interrupt. We need to get.
But you said something that I want to clarify. They will still pay the tax in their regular payroll.
They'll get a credit. If you're asking me if it's going to show what the thing is or they get a check, I do not know that
answer. No, it's not even that. How they get it is irrelevant to me. But whenever they get paid, they'll still see the utilized tax deduction, correct?
That's what we're trying. I will have to figure all that out. I don't know exactly how the refunding process is going to work.
Okay, because I mean, a number of people that have mentioned it to me have said they kind of, their understanding is it's just going to disappear from the paycheck, but I'm thinking.
No, we federally still have to take that money out. What's going to happen? We're getting no cooking on it, but I'm speaking before I truly research an option. You're going to pay it, and then you're going to get a refund check back from part of it. Company that does our taxes.
How do you get it back?
Let's hold the rest of this till Randy can dig in deep.
I don't want to
put Randy on the spot and make him say something.
It's going to continue to come out of your check.
So.
And if you don't know, I won't say anything.
I would just not say anything.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay, moving on. Down to anyone else on the audience that we've before? Thank you. Committee reports on tonight, resolutions, none will drop down to ordinances, four introductions, one of action. Mr. Collier.
We actually have three introductions and one action.
Yeah, we have four introductions and one action.
You can't be honest.
That's what you're talking about. Three more sets.
Or intro.
So four intro.
Yeah, and one and then
four
intro. Okay.
Let's play on four intro.
One intro, one thing. Intro.
Okay.
Ordinance 17-30, introduction tonight, public hearing and action on 9/17. An ordinance amending section 1040 of the codified ordinances of the city of New Carlisle regarding online utility payments. Ordinance 17-31, introduction tonight, public hearing and action on 9/18/17. An ordinance amending section 1042 of the codified ordinances of the City of New Carlisle regarding online utility payments. Ordinance 17-32, introduction tonight, public hearing and action on 9/18/17. An ordinance of the City Council of New Carlisle, Ohio, authorizing a credit card processing fee for all credit card transactions at the City Administration Building. Ordinance 17-33E, introduction, public hearing and action tonight. An ordinance amending section 246 of the codified ordinances of the city of New Carlisle regarding employment policy statements and declaring an emergency.
I move adopt ordinance 17-33.
Second.
You got the first, Lovely. Second for,
Normally I would give the explanation of this ordinance, but this is a state law update, so I'll let our attorney take it from here.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, Council. This ordinance is drafted to bring essentially what is a policy handbook that is codified into ordinances up to snuff with legislature that was passed in March in order to allow employees to carry handguns that have a concealed carry permit to work, but they are obligated to keep their weapon in their car in compliance with CCWA. It does not allow them to bring the weapon or any ammunition into work or to take it out of the car.
Any questions or comments? Thank you, Mr. Staper. Are you ready, Mr. Gallagher?
Sure, discussion, I think I've ever heard.
Mr. Ledley?
Yes.
Mr. Krabacher?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Lighty?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Ordinance 1733E passes 6-0, and it did require 6 votes to pass.
Thank you, sir. We'll drop down on the business, but also apparently we need to excuse Mr. Reynolds.
Mr. Mayor.
Okay. Mr. Wendy.
Make a motion that we excuse Councilman Reynolds for a second.
Mr. Krabacher?
Yes.
Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Lighty?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lethley?
Yes.
Mr. Reynolds is excused, 6-0.
Thank you, sir. Other business, when you're ready.
Moving on to other business.
Yes, sir.
Seven, ready.
Ready.
Congressman Warren Davison will hold mobile office hours at the City Building on the fourth Tuesday of each month from 1:30 p.m. until 2 p.m. The next Crime Watch meeting will be Wednesday, September the 13th at 6:30 p.m. here at Smith Park Shelter House. That's all I have.
Thank you,
sir. Mr. Lindsay.
I move that we adjourn to going to executive session.
Second.
And yeah, we got one longer in the team already.
Go ahead,
Ben. We'll move into executive council will hold an executive session to consider pending litigation regarding the Bartlett Tax Credit Initiative petition, Board of Elections matter. And then next on the agenda, the executive session, the council will hold an executive session to consider the dismissal and or compensation of public employees.
And Mayor, I will add that when I type that motion up, I'll put all that language.
Thank you, sir.
All right. Mr. Krabacher?
Yes.
Mr. Mayor Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lindsay?
Yes.
Mr. Light?
Yes.
Mr. Rick Lowry?
Yes.
Mr. Lethley?
Yes.
We go into executive session, passes 6-0.
Take 5 minutes. Yes.
Here, for the benefit of the general public, it's fair to say that we're going to adjourn and not conduct any.
I was just going to ask that question.
Yeah, no voting.
Can I do it?
After the executive session.